John, you are very well known in the horticulture industry for your ability to graft, and many of these dwarf conifers are as a result. So I'm looking forward to you demonstrating it, but before we get going, I just want to remind everybody that we'd love to have some of your gardening questions from Facebook or phone calls or from emails so that we can answer them for you during the show or even afterwards if we don't get to them. So John, why, you know, these unique plant specimens, but why would people graft plants?
Well, these all are specimens that show different reasons. For the one on the left there, we did a high graft, and the reason for that is if you did a container display for a winter garden, this would give you the vertical accent and give you room for herbaceous plants underneath.
Like Brenda's blue spruces that were in her yard.
Called a high graft.
Okay.
This one is a Japanese maple called Skeeter's Broom, and it's a low graft. Bonsai enthusiasts like to have that graft as low as possible. And also you have colored stem Jap maples like Sango Kaku. You need to have that low so you don't see the differentiation between colors of stems. So again, with 500 varieties of Japanese maples, and they all don't produce very good root systems, you have to graft.
So that you've got beautiful tops with strong roots.
And not only that, you can graft 8 different species on one type of species plant.
Oh, fun.
So that's really fun.
That is fun.
The pear on the right here, if you look at the base, you'll see the graft union, and it looks like a little J. People in garden centers, it drives them crazy. But that's the graft union, and within 3 to 5 years, that disappears. But the reason for grafting trees like that, they don't have very good root systems, so you find the best root stock. And a lot of people in the upper mid-Atlantic nurserymen, they look for that good root stock because they're doing infield digging. And so you have to have a good root base.
Right, to be able to have that plant survive.
Exactly.
Yes.
Or not fall over.
Exactly. But you also have to make sure that graft doesn't get covered either.
Exactly, right.
Yes.
So we have what we have here is what we call the understock. Okay. And then if we're going to put a piece of wood on top of it, which basically we're matching two pieces of wood. Now if you look at this piece of wood, we see the bark, but if you scratch through it, you'll see a little bit of green in there.
Well, it doesn't
show very much because there's not much.
Yeah.
The cambium is the growing part of the plant, and you're going to have to match the cambiums of the signwood and the understock. So we have to go with our tools. Now, the grafting knife can be very expensive, but the thing about this grafting knife is that in a regular pocket knife, we have a bevel like this. But in a grafting knife, we have a half bevel. And that's so when you pull your knife through, it grabs in and makes the right cut.
Okay.
So the technique is, we have to get our knife in our hand and halfway up the blade like this so we don't puncture our stomach.
Where are the Band-Aids?
That's right, get the Band-Aids out. But here is the pull, that's it. We don't whittle, we don't wobble, we just pull.
One complete
slice.
Motion.
So now we have a wedge. All right. So again, I would sterilize everything, but we're on TV here, so we're not doing that right now. But we make a cut like this. Now, this plant is a deciduous plant, and we can do that in the summer, and we can do that in late winter.
Okay.
All right. Now, I use a technique called a side veneer graft, but there's whip and tongue, cleft, saddle, and chip, and T-budding, right?
Right.
So now I match the diameter, and I see I have to make a cut right about there, and I make a little strip. So if you can see that with the audience there, I've got a little flap there, okay? Now I take this and I match it. So the cambiums are matching just right.
Now the cambiums are right underneath that bark.
Right. The green is the growing area. It's always the same size. It doesn't get bigger with the age.
Nope.
It's always that year's growth. And we know by the rings of a tree,
right?
So now the other tool is to tie it up. And this is a grafting rubber strip. So we take it and we wrap it around here like this. And we go around several times.
And then it's like
tying a balloon. We go underneath and we make a little thing like that.
Okay, let's flip it to the side so you can see
there's a little flap here. Now this rubber band will degrade over several months, so it's not a big issue. And if it's finally taken, you can just pull that off and the rubber band will come off.
Okay, so you can see, people can see where your flap was.
Right.
And they put the cyan wood to match the cambiums. It doesn't go in the middle, it goes to the edge.
Right, it matches the cambium.
The cambiums, right? And then you wrapped it tightly.
Now, that's just to wrap it tightly so it connects. So it's got to meet, right? Now we have to seal it, and there's a lot of things out in the marketplace. long time ago was beeswax.
I remember that.
Oh, you have to melt the beeswax. It's got to be 105 degrees.
Such a mess.
I've gone through three fondue pots doing that. Oh,
yes.
It's amazing.
Yes.
So in the 80s, a research scientist went into the industry and she brought along this product. It's called Parafilm M, and it's like a super duper saran wrap. It stretches.
Nice.
So now we can just take this and tie it around like this. All right, and this is sealing it at the same time as bringing it together.
Making it sort of waterproof?
It makes it waterproof. So now this is sealed up. So again, we could use that. You can use tree paint. A friend of mine used masking tape and kite string. You know, there's many ways of tying that together, but this is what the industry uses.
Mm-hmm.
So this would be a deciduous graft. Again, we would do this in the summer and late winter when the sap is rising. That's what's really important.
That those cambiums will meet and the sap will go into the new.
Exactly, and then it'll push growth.
Uh-huh.
Now, the evergreen understock is different because we can't take the leaves off of this.
Right.
Okay? This can only occur in late winter.
So when it's dormant.
When it's dormant, and we want that sap coming up.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a little more difficult to do the evergreens because we need a source of bottom heat, and not everybody can supply that. So if you've got fluctuation temperatures, you stop the sap, and then it goes, and it stops.
Oh, that's nice.
So we have to be careful with this. And at the end of this, what happens is I would make the same cut as this here,
mm-hmm.
and then do my graft, and then I would use a plastic bag to cover that so it doesn't desiccate.
Okay.
Now, we don't have to worry about desiccation here because there's no leaves,
mm-hmm.
right?
And there's no leaves.
Right. So again, this plant, if you see this tag, this is a semi-dwarf rootstock. So what I'll get is a semi-dwarf apple tree.
Okay.
So the rootstocks can influence the growth of the plants.
And people don't realize the importance
right.
of the fact that the part the rootstock plays in creating the plant that we're enjoying.
Right. And we saw the dwarf conifer in the other session. I spent 40 minutes today trying to knock a witch's broom out of a pine tree.
No.
To bring to the station today.
Witch's so. Broom is an abnormal growth in
exactly.
a pine tree where it gets very tight and distorted, and it's highly valued to want to be able to graft.
I drive down the highways now all the time looking for that congested growth. You know, I've counted 14 between here and Lynchburg one day, and one was a bright yellow one, so that was pretty interesting. And if you think about it, almost all our dwarf conifers in the marketplace originated as witch's brooms.
Yes.
So it's very interesting.
Well, I actually have one at Maymont and that Japanese maple that we have.
Oh.
Nice witch's broom.
Which
John
is
will come
Skeeters,
visiting soon.
Yeah, the Skeeters is a witch's broom here.
Yes, so, exactly.
Yeah. So, but that's, you know, it's a fun thing to do. It's a horticultural art that's been practiced for 2,000 years, but it still has problems.
Yes.
And some of those problems are very common, like a white and pink dogwood.
Mm-hmm.
Well, the pink goes on the white dogwood seedling, right?
Right.
Green and red maple. Well, same thing. The green seedling is the understock and the red was other. Then you have one of the worst things is a hybrid tea rose where the understock grows up. I have one client who lost 40 of them.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
Oh, poor guy. John, thank you for giving us grafting in 3 minutes or less. We truly appreciate this years and years of expertise
well,
being shown here on this show and sharing some of our challenges as well.